Hi, I'm Cheryl Hilbrant, Rescue Squad Captain for the Tivoli Rescue Squad. What you see behind me is a simulated auto accident that we are going to use as a drill today at the Red Hook High School. It's pre-prom for the senior class. Involved is the Red Hook Fire Department, the Tivoli Fire Department Rescue Squad, MVP, and the Red Hook Police Department. Please remember, this is only simulated, it's all actors involved.
Challenging.
Oh, yeah, that's the volunteer. Okay, now. Yeah.
AB273 per Glenham, correction, per Glenham Command, you're back in service at 0928. Dispatch with 0911, 1418.
that was a bad day for you. It happens to everybody. This is one of these things you can completely, totally, absolutely prevent. Don't drink, don't do drugs, period, and don't drive when you're doing those if you're going to do them. Just don't do it. Just that simple. But let's say you did, you're in trouble, you're arrested, somebody died as a result of what you did. So what's going to happen is, not the first thing, is you're going to hire an attorney. Wait for that bell. You're going to hire an attorney. Why? Because you don't have a choice. The job of the attorney is to minimize the damage and the problems that you've created because of a really bad decision. It doesn't mean that you're going to get off completely. It doesn't mean that you're not going to go to jail. It means that the attorney is going to try and make your life as best as it can be after you've made this very poor decision. So in the scenario that you have, someone passed away, someone died. The punchline at the end of the day is you're going to go to jail for that for a very long period of time. There was an accident that happened at Pine Plains. You may or may not know about it. Didn't involve alcohol, involved drugs, marijuana, drink, driving. And the person is going to serve 6 to 18 years of their life in jail. Your age, 6 to 18 years of your life in jail. How old are you? 18. So double the time that you're alive, you could be in jail for one dumb mistake. Keep that in mind. I'm not here to scare anybody. I was a parent. I was 18. I was sitting in this chair. When I was 18, you could drink. It was legal. It was okay. Doesn't mean you can drink and drive. It doesn't mean you can kill somebody. So, you know, when your parents are saying, God, when I was 18, we could drink. You could join the military. You could fight for, you know, their country and you can die and you can't have a beer. I'm not here to pass judgment on that. What I'm saying is you can't drink and drive. You can't do drugs and drive. You do, someone dies, you're going to jail. I don't care who you hire. So let's say you call me up and say, okay, your parents, you're in jail by now because you have been arraigned. We'll talk about that in a minute. And as town judge for the town of Red Hook, I would have arraigned you probably. We'll talk about that in a minute. That just happened. You're now in jail. Your parents call and say, my son or daughter, big trouble, accident, someone died. Now what? I say, come in, let's talk. We'll need to talk about this. The first thing you need to think about, not you, is to hire an attorney. For a fatality, you're going to pay that attorney an enormous amount of money, probably $10,000 before the attorney will even do anything for you, probably more. That's probably on the low slide. So college, vacation money, whatever it is your parents have accumulated, it's going to be paid to that attorney, and a lot more of it, a lot of money. It's beyond belief with a fatality. So think about that. The attorney then contacts the DA. There's no prosecutor here today, but the district attorney's office is the person or the agency that prosecutes against you. They're very good, and they're very... So their job is the people of the state of New York against whoever you are. They're going to prosecute against you. They represent the people of the state of New York. They're not going to cut you any deals. They're not going to give you any breaks because you're young. Why? Because the parents of the child who died is going to come to court every single time. And they're going to sit there and they're going to remember that you killed their son or their daughter. And they're not going to give you any break. Why? Because the district attorney's elected. And politics, I stay out of politics. But when you're an elected official and you have parents whose son or daughter died in your courtroom, you're not going to give the person, great job in that play, you're not going to give that person a break. And you shouldn't, by the way. You shouldn't. So when you're looking at a fatality, when you're looking at as the defendant, you're in really big trouble. Big trouble. Your hope is that, we're not going to get into this today, but it might be a technicality. The police officer might have somehow screwed up. Somehow somebody messed up the paperwork. It happens. Don't bank on it. Please don't bank on it. But maybe you get lucky, but maybe probably you won't. So at the end of the day, when this is all said and done, you're going to go to jail. You're going to go to jail for a very long time. And the life as you know it is not going to be what you had hoped it would be. So you grow up. You play Little League. you're doing what you're supposed to do, you're going to graduate, and you get in trouble, you're going to go to jail, and you're not going to get out for a very long time period. 6 years, if you're 18, you know, you're 24, you could be out of law school by that time, almost. Man, what can I tell you? Just don't do it. So, having said that, let's go back a little bit. You're going to be arraigned in front of a judge. I'll put my judge hat on now. I get called at 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to meet you in the town of Red Hook Justice Court. You probably will have some kind of attorney there with you, and you're going to enter a plea of not guilty. Everybody pleads not guilty. Everybody pleads not guilty just because you do. You don't go to court and say you plead guilty. If you did, I wouldn't take the plea. I wouldn't let you do that. You're going to plead not guilty. You're going to waive the reading of the rights and charges, preserve all rights or motions. You're going to go to jail. Probably will not set bail for this. So you're not going to get out. I don't care if you're a billionaire. You won't get out of jail because no bail will be posted. Everybody get that? No bail. Go to jail. Why? Because that's the way it works. Not because I'm mean. I don't think I am. But you're just not going to get out. And you're going to stay in jail for a long time. So one night you have your prom dress on, the next night you're going to be in jail for the next year, 6 years of your life. Think about that. Not good, obviously. So let's talk about alcohol. Before I do that. So you're now arraigned, you go to county court with lots of people that are there that maybe should be there. You're not one of them, but you're not going to meet all these people that are in jail for whatever reason they're in jail. And it's probably not going to be a very pleasant experience for you. Because everybody that's going to book you at the jail is going to know why you're there, and they're accused of killing someone. You think they're going to be in a good mood seeing you there? Maybe it's their neighbor. Maybe it's just somebody they know. Or maybe it's not, but they have a child who's 16 and they're looking at you and saying, you could have killed my kid. They're going to be in a grumpy mood at 3 o'clock in the morning when they see you walk into the jail and be processed. They take your clothes off. They put their fingers in places you don't want people to put their fingers. Every single person gets processed that way. You're not special. And then they're going to put you in a holding cell somewhere. And then they're going to put you in a group cell with people that you probably don't normally associate with. And then you're going to stay there until the trial. 6 months, 8 months. The woman who was accused of killing the Tivoli kids, you read about that in the paper. She was, you know, in Dutchess County Jail until she finally pled guilty. She's, you know, probably not going to get out, chances are. Older woman, and she was sentenced for a long time. She's not going to get out. She's going to die, probably in jail. I hope there's no relatives in the audience. If there are, I'm sorry. But that's the way it is. That's what happened. Two people, dead. Two. Okay, so having said that, you're now going to go to court. And you're going to go to court, probably not in Red Hook, it'll be in county court, because county court handles the felony cases. Red Hook handles up to misdemeanor cases. Misdemeanor means up to a year in jail. Anything more than a year in jail is handled in county court in Poughkeepsie, Judge Greller or Judge Foreman, both of whom were prior prosecutors. So you're in front of a judge who used to be a prosecutor. You think that judge is going to feel sorry for you in any way, shape, or manner? No. Not happening. You're going to hire your attorney, you're going to go through the court system, maybe you're going to go to trial if you have some kind of a real interesting technical issue. Officer Hillbrand's going to testify, he's going to do a great job because he's a really good officer and he knows what he's doing. And as soon as he testifies, the jury's going to convict you. Why? Because he's wearing a uniform and he's trustworthy and they're going to believe him. That's what usually happens. And once they hear that reading, 1-5, something like that, almost double the limit, you're sunk. You're going to go to jail. Then the judge eventually sentences you 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, 18 years. Nothing anybody can do about it. You're going to go to state prison somewhere in the middle of who knows where. Not locally. Somewhere. Your parents will come and visit you maybe once a week if you're lucky. Then they'll go to once a month. And you're going to be in a cell with Bubba or somebody who just wants to... can't wait to see you, young person in the cell. You know what happens in jail? It's not a, you know, I'm not kidding. Those things happen. So, not a good thing to think about. Okay, having said that, let's pretend for a moment that this is a standard DWI. You're drinking, prom night, you get caught, thank God nobody gets killed, but you still get a DWI. If you're thinking, oh God, thank God it's just that, think about that again. A DWI is going to cost you a couple thousand dollars to hire the attorney, at least two, three, four, five, depending on how complicated. And you're going to need to go to justice court in front of me. That'll continue for I don't know how many months. In the meantime, you're going to go to college. I don't know. Who's going to pay for the attorney? And if you plead guilty, there's a fine, $1,000, something like that. They take your license as soon as you go to court. So now you're not going to be able to drive. So on the date of arraignment, I plead not guilty. I need to take your license, not because I'm mean. The law says I have to. Do you get a conditional license? Probably not. So you're not driving. So now what? How are you going to work? How are you going to go to college? What's going to happen? I don't have an answer for you. That's a real problem. So eventually you plead guilty maybe to DWI. That's a misdemeanor. That might not mean anything to you, but when you apply for college, the very last question usually, have you ever been convicted of a crime? The answer is yes, DWI. When you apply for your first job, have you ever been convicted of a crime? The answer is yes, DWI. Who's going to hire you with that? So if you're an employer, if you're the Red Hook Central School District, you go to college, you get your teaching degree, and your Mr. Paisley's now going to interview you. And you have these great grades, and the question is, have you ever been convicted of a crime? The answer is yes, DWI. You're going to need to really explain that. What are you going to say? I don't know. I know what I would say. Thank God I didn't have to. I'd say I was young, I was dumb, I was stupid, I made a very poor choice, thank God I didn't kill anybody, I learned my lesson, I never drove and drank again, I've taught seminars about this, I dodged a bullet, I'm the luckiest guy I know, and I want to teach kids in your school about the very bad decision I made. That's what I would say. I don't know if that'd work, but that's what I would say. And at sentencing, if I killed somebody, God forbid, and I have all these people, these are all these people here that night that were called out from their home, some of whom, many of whom do not get paid to do what they do. Most of these people are volunteers. Cheryl Hillbrand, her husband, Mr. Hillbrand, all these people, Jim Mulder, these guys don't get paid to do what they do. And yet 3 o'clock in the morning, they're being pulled out of their homes to take care of a situation that could have been prevented because of what you did. And they're gonna clean up the mess, pick up the pieces, talk to the parents whose kid you just killed. Can you imagine doing that and not getting paid? I mean, now you don't get paid to do it. I don't care if you got paid $1 million for that night, it still wouldn't be enough money to do what these people have to do sometimes, but they're doing it, that's what they do. And what I hope for you and for my children is that somebody comes back to Red Hook and does what these guys do. It's a great town. You know, don't think you have to grow up and leave. You don't have to do that. It's a great place to live. And participate in the community. Memorial Day parades are the best. Why? You get to see all the people who are the fabric of the community. It's not just the politicians. It's these people who are marching in the parade. You know, those are the people that make up this community. And they're out to help you. And they're out to help people who make poor decisions. But they're going to be out that night from their families cleaning up that mess that you've created. Okay, so what are we going to do about this? So what do we do about this is you... How much time do I have, by the way? Okay. So what we do about this, first of all, is you don't make the mistake of having a drink or doing drugs and getting behind the wheel. That's really simple. Just don't do it. If you're thinking of doing it, don't do it. Don't let your friends do it. Everybody's, you know, senior, life is great, infallible. You're going to live forever. You can't make any mistakes. You graduated. It's really great. But I promise you, you could make a really bad mistake. Just don't do it. Don't. Another thing. All those people who have fake ID cards. Those are felonies, by the way. You're carrying a felony crime in your pocket. What does that mean? Punishable up more than a year in jail. So a misdemeanor DWI is punishable up to 1 year in the Dutchess County Jail. You have a fake ID, that's punishable at least a year plus a day in some state penitentiary somewhere. So you get stopped for DWI, Officer Hillbrand has an obligation, not because he's nosing. He's got to go through your car. He's got to secure the contents. He finds some marijuana, he finds I don't know what else, he finds a fake ID. you're now going to get charged in addition to your vehicular homicide, you're going to have a felony fake ID charge plus marijuana or whatever else you've got. So it's just not the DWI you have to worry about. It's all those things he's going to find in the car that you thought nobody's going to catch you because you hit it so well. Officer Hillbrant knows what he's doing. He's going to find it. If you think he's not going to find it, you're nuts. He's going to find it. Of course he's going to find it. And now you've got real problems. And pretend it's not a vehicular homicide. Say you're driving with a friend who had just a couple of beers, just a little bit buzzed. A little bit buzzed for you is a .02, which means one drink. And because you're under 21, you can't drink in New York State, by the way. I know you know this, but it's easy to forget that. Oh, by the way, you're not supposed to be drinking anyway. Like, that's against the law to begin with. But we'll get past that for a minute, and you have a drink. You are now .02, guaranteed. Because of your age, you're not supposed to be drinking. A .05 or .08 of a blood alcohol content is a DWAI, driving while ability impaired. That's not a misdemeanor. But because of your age, it starts at .02. One drink, you get behind the wheel, you're in trouble. Just that simple. You're in trouble. If you blow a .08 or above, that's DWI, that's a misdemeanor. And .18 or above is aggravated DWI. Stiffer penalties, more problems, higher fines, probation, meaning for the next 3 years of your life, you're going to meet with a probation officer once a month. And once you pay the $1,500 fine in court, you're going to get a conditional license if you're lucky, but not for a year because you're so young. But when you get your conditional license, you're going to pay a fine for that. And when you meet your probation officer, you're going to pay $35-$50 every single time. Where are you going to get this money from if you don't have a job and you can't work and you can't drive? I don't have an answer for that. But you can understand that what I'm trying to say to you is not to scare you, but maybe it is. What I'm trying to say to you is one little mistake that you can completely avoid will cost you more than you could possibly imagine. I just can't tell you how your life will be changed and your parents' life, your sisters, your brothers, everybody's life is going to be changed because of what you did. And it could be completely avoided. Just very simply avoid it. All right, so how do you do this? You're drinking, which you shouldn't be doing, by the way, but you're doing it. And you're the only one who's got the keys, and you've got the car, and you've got to get somewhere, or else your parents are going to kill you. My suggestion is walk. Just don't drive. Call somebody. If you don't have your phone, you walk. That's what happens. Just don't drive. It's bad enough that you drank. That's one thing. We'll deal with that. But just don't drive. It's just don't do it. So that's how you avoid the situation. Where's the prom going to be held this year, by the way? Sorority's at Swan Place or whatever it is. So you're taking, is everybody driving? Are you taking, how does this work? Not like it was when I was a kid. I mean, you got in the car and you drove, whatever. But you're taking buses, vans, some people driving, all of that? Is that how it works? And then there's a post-prom party at Bard again, and everybody goes to that, I hope. And then after that, you're tired and you go home, hopefully. No. You go to the diner. The Red Hook Diner? All right. Okay, so there's a lot more we can talk about right now. I just want to open it up for any questions anybody might have about anything I might say. The actor, yes, where are you going? College. Excellent. Okay, so, all right, so the question is there a fatality in all of them? All right, so the question is, there's a fatality, but it was caused by a texting, black ice. We talked about DWI, you're in big trouble, we talked about that. If it's a black ice fatality, that's not necessarily a crime. So you're driving your car, you hit black ice, you didn't do anything wrong, it just is what it is, and you swerve, you go to an oncoming car, and there's a fatality. There may not be any charges brought at all. If you weren't speeding, you weren't doing anything wrong, you're minding your own business, driving your car, it happens to everybody. Black ice means you don't see it. It's on the road, you don't see it. And you're not going over the speed, and you swerve, somebody gets hit and somebody, you know, you get in an accident, someone passes away, that's not necessarily a crime in New York State, unless you're doing something else. If you're doing something else, you're texting, you're not paying attention, that's negligence, but there's also a crime, there's a statute involved in that. I don't know, the 1229C or whatever it is, you're operating your phone, that's a 5-point, it could be a 5-point violation, which is a big deal, but it's, it could be elevated to a more elevated felony crime, depending on how the prosecutor views this. And this is, you know, you really ask a good question. You get your attorney and you start negotiating with the DA, your attorney has to convince the DA that you're the best kid that ever walked the face of the earth. And there's ways to do that. And the prosecutor has to be convinced that you're not a problem kid, you got good grades, you're going to college, all of these wonderful things, and you just had a bad night, it was a stupid day. I mean, those kinds of things all fall into play. But, you know, one thing you've learned already in second grade, first grade, whatever it is, how many times have you said to yourself, you know, life is not fair. Like, how come this kid gets away with this, and every single time I do something, I get in trouble? Why is that? It's just the way it is. Life isn't fair. Some kids get away with everything, and some kids, they can't look funny without getting caught. But that's the way it is in real life, by the way. So you might dodge a bullet. You might do something and dodge a bullet and get away with it. You might run against the prosecutor who is absolutely born to put you in jail. And they've got your case and they're going to prosecute you until they die. And you could have one of those prosecutors. So really, there's a lot of factors that are involved, and the judge obviously is a factor as well. So, really good question, though. Excellent. Did I answer it? Kind of. All right. Then I did my job. Anytime, that's a good thing. Who else? Gotta have questions. Yes. Okay. There's a statistic that somebody wrote an article about falling asleep, which is equivalent to actually driving while intoxicated. So you're feeling the same thing. You're not intoxicated, you didn't have anything to drink, but you're feeling the same thing. Your reactions when you're driving are limited, slow. You know, we're all tired and we all drive, unfortunately, sometimes when we're tired. So that is not necessarily a crime. If you didn't, you know, you're not drinking, you're not doing anything wrong, you're not texting, you fall asleep. And you cross the lane. Crossing the lane is a violation, a vehicle traffic violation, so you did something wrong and you caused an accident. Chances are, unless there's other things involved, you're not going to be arrested for, you know, something very, very serious unless it can be shown that you did something was going on, whatever that something is. But the problem is that you're going to be sued big time for causing an accident and causing injuries or causing someone's death. So it's less of a... it's less of a problem on the criminal aspect, but it's a problem civilly. You're going to need to live the rest of your life knowing that you fell asleep and caused a really bad accident. So you know something, I'm a victim of being tired. So I've learned in my ancient age, if I'm tired, I'll pull off the side of the road and fall asleep. I do that. Like if you see my car alongside the road 2 o'clock in the morning, chances are I'm sleeping. I'm just tired. And that's the chance. I'm not doing anything else. I'm just tired. So I'm not kidding. So I pick up Maria from Ithaca College. I'm driving home. You know what? I am tired. So I pulled off the side of the road. I fall asleep till 4 o'clock in the morning. My wife says, what the hell? Where were you? Like, what? And she knows. I fell asleep. You know, it happens. You got to do that. Do it. Just do it. Go to sleep, go in the car, call somebody, say, look, I'm taking a nap for 2 hours, I'm checking out. Better that than going across the road. Oh, personal experience on that. Who else? Yes?
If both drivers are killed in an accident, can fines be made to the family?
Tell me that again. Both drivers are what?
Both drivers are killed in an accident, but one was under the influence. Can the fines be paid to the family of the driver who was under the influence?
So let me get the scenario. The two drivers in an accident. One is under the influence, intoxicated or whatever, and the other is not. And so then the question is what?
They both died.
Right.
Can anything happen to the family of the one in the
Oh, yeah. Okay, good question. So this is a pretty morbid situation, but you're driving a car, and your friend is driving the other car, and you get in an accident, you both pass away. Pretty awful. But that could happen. So what happens is, realistically, this is more of a civil thing, but somebody's going to sue somebody. Just because you're dead doesn't mean you're not going to get sued. You're going to get sued. So what's going to happen, and it's about money, by the way, it's just about money. You're dead, they can't bring you back to life. That's not going to happen. But that doesn't mean your family can't sue on your behalf for pain and suffering and for injuries that you receive. You're not going to be around to get the money, but your family will, and the insurance companies are going to need to pay out. So I don't know if that answers your question, but just because you're not here anymore doesn't mean a lawsuit won't happen. But let's say, I'm going to take a little twist on that. You're the driver, and you're the one who gets killed from a drunk driver. So you're not here anymore, but your family could sue the drunk driver, even though you're not here. But it's compensatory damages, pain and suffering, that sort of thing, that your family will collect on from the drunk driver's insurance company. Pretty morbid stuff. Let's talk about baseball, right? How's baseball? Good. Good. Congratulations. Division III. Yes. Great. Super great question. I'm going to twist that a little bit, though. This is the question of the day. You're driving the car, and you're in possession of something you shouldn't have. Use your imagination, and you get stopped. Officer Hildebrand's going to come over. He's going to pull you over for a simple, crossing a line or, something simple. Everyday, no-brainer stuff, speeding, whatever. He goes to your car, and he looks down, and he sees a rolled up $1 bill. Like, why are $1 bills rolled up? Use your imagination, you're not dumb, you know why. And so does he. And so he says, maybe you need to step out of the car a little bit, and then when you do that, something falls out of your lap that you thought, oh my God. Now you're in trouble. So the least of your worries is a speeding ticket. You've got a possession charge, criminal possession of controlled substance, a misdemeanor, punishable up to a year in jail, and whatever else he's gonna find, and you're in big trouble. You're just in big trouble. You could go to jail for a year for that, a year. And I don't think I'm a mean guy, but when I have kids come into the court, my job is to help them not ever make that mistake again, ever. So, tough love really works. You're not gonna get a lot of sympathy from me at all. If you're that young and if you have drugs, you will get hardly any sympathy at all. But I'm going to twist that around. You're driving the car, the back seat, you pick up your friend with her bag, and she puts it in the trunk, or she puts it in the back seat, and you're driving and you're going, to Albany, and you get stopped for speeding, not the end of the world, it happens, and the officer comes up, and you get a little cranky with the officer, dumb mistake. Yes, sir, no, sir, yes, ma'am, yes, sir, by the way. You made a mistake, even if you didn't make a mistake. Yes, sir, yes, ma'am, yes, sir. Don't get dumb, don't get cranky, don't be stupid when an officer stops you, even if you did nothing wrong and you're so upset and you think they have an attitude. They don't have an attitude, even if they do, and you're polite. Don't make it worse for yourself. How many times, hundreds? Of times, I'm sure. Thousands. You're stopping somebody. I'm not the officer here, but you get stopped, and you have a young, polite, intelligent student kid in the car who knows their manners, and they were taught well. I'm not going to tell you what could happen, but chances are you're going to get a pretty good deal. Patrick doesn't need your problems. Okay, he wants to see a nice, happy person. He's got the bad guys to go after. But you give him a problem, you give him an attitude, what do you think is going to happen? How stupid is that? Just don't do that. All right, take your ego and put it away somewhere. It's yes, sir, yes, officer, yes, ma'am, yes, officer. Just do it. Don't be dumb. But your friend's got something in the back in that bag that she didn't tell you about. So there's four people in the car. I can't tell you how many cases I've had like this. I just can't tell you. I can't keep track of the number. and something happens, you give the officer a problem, now everybody's going to get out of the car, and then you're going to get your bag searched because the officer asked you, can I search your bags? You probably said yes, even though you can say no. That's another topic for another day. We should have something, how to get out of fill in the blank. I'd love to teach that, truly, I really would, but not today. What? Okay. So we can talk about that. That's a lot of fun, how to get out of it. But you've got a friend in the back seat who's got a bag full of heroin, and you don't know it. You have no clue that your friend has a bag full of heroin. And so you're going to be asked to be out of the car. Your friend's going to open up the bag. And guess who's going to be arrested for possession? You. And everybody else. Because everybody's going to say, oh, wasn't mine. How many times have you heard that? It's not mine. It's not mine. It's not mine. So it's got to be somebody. So guess what? The officer's going to arrest every single one of you in the car. Why? Not because he's mean, because somebody in this car owns whatever's in the car. And we're going to arrest every single one of them. And now you're going to have to hire your attorney for $2,500, so $3,500 with a possession case. And you didn't do it. You're just riding in the car. You got, what's your name? I'm sorry. Stacy? That's easy. Thank you. So Stacy picks you up. You're in the front seat. She picks her other friend up. You're minding your own business. Her other friend's got the bag of whatever it is. You get arrested. And you're going to have to hire an attorney for a lot of money just because you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. Hopefully, the person who owns it is going to step up to the plate and say, look, it's mine and it's not theirs. But you know what? That person may not be believable. So I've had, and Patrick, you know where I'm going with this. So I represent the driver, maybe I represent the passenger, and my client says, look, it's mine. And I say, okay, you know, this is what's gonna happen to you. You're sure it's yours, it's mine. But it's not theirs. They're taking the fall for somebody else. I mean, it happens all the time. So just because someone said it's mine doesn't mean that you're gonna be believed or that person is gonna be believed. So it's not as simple as you think, truly. I'm not kidding. Did I answer your question? Okay. Who else? Yes. So you're asking me as an attorney, as a judge, as a parent, or is it just a human being who pays taxes? Let's talk about the human being who pays taxes. I thought the answer to that question was yes. And when I started practicing law 30 years ago, it's 30 years this year, Space Shuttle blew up, you guys weren't alive. That's the day I said I get inducted, you were around. And 30 years ago, but I had a discussion with a prosecutor, Wayne Witherwax, who's a confidential law clerk to Judge Greller now, county court. You kill somebody, you're going to be in front of Judge Greller. He is his confidential law clerk. And I said to Wayne, and my client blew like a 1-2. Or 1-3. And I said, Wayne, you know, that's not that big of a deal, Wayne. It's a 1-3. Stop. And he said, Jeff, I'm going to tell you something. As a DWI prosecutor, I'm obligated to go to these DWI prosecutor seminars. And they're overnight seminars for weekends, during weekends. And the DWI prosecutors are invited, but not obligated, to drink on purpose. And they drink, and then they blow into the breathalyzer at the time, now it's an intoxilizer, and they blow in and they figure out what their reading was. And so I'm going to quote Wayne, please, for virgin ears, I'm sorry. And he said, Jeff, I blew into the machine, it was a 0.12 and I was shift-based. A 0.12. I said, Wayne, you're kidding. He said, Jeff, I'm not kidding. There goes my argument. Why? Because he's believable. I trusted him. And so I learned a lesson. What I do is there's no consequence to you, but I don't drink. I just don't. I see too many things that happen. It's just not worth it. So I don't do that. But for friends that do, a 0.12 is not considered to be like a big deal, but it is. I mean, you're really not. You're waving. You're slurring. Your eyes are glassed. Slurring your speech. You're wobbling. You're not going to pass that field sobriety test. Chances are, not going to happen. So, as a human being who pays taxes, I thought maybe it was too low, but it's not. As an attorney, it's not up to me to judge. So You'll never know this, I hope, but when you go to see your attorney when you're in trouble, you don't want that attorney looking at you and judging you. That's the last thing you want. I've learned, I mean, obviously you just don't do that. I don't judge anybody. So if you come in and you're accused of something, I'm not sitting here passing judgment on you. Never. Never. So I don't do that. As a judge, ironically, I don't do that either. I don't judge you. What I do is I try to help you. So if I think there's something I can do to help you, I'll do that. But I don't look at you saying, oh my God, how did you get in this situation? Never. The reason why, honestly, is because, you know, I was 18 and I went to high school. And, you know, I got lucky. So I could have been standing there. Most of the times people do something, I'm thinking to myself, boy, you know, at some point, except for the really bad things, maybe that could have been me. So I dodged some bullets too, like we all do, thank God. Hopefully I answered your question on that. Anybody else? Yes. That's probably not a crime. So it's a very unfortunate circumstance. It happens, but you didn't do anything wrong, and that's the way it goes. I mean, you just didn't do anything wrong. So you're not going to be arrested. You might be sued, but you're not going to be arrested. You just didn't do anything wrong. So it's that simple. You didn't commit a crime. Under that scenario, driving, you're minding your own business, someone pulls out, bang out, someone dies. That's not a crime. It's a really sad day, but it's not a crime. There was one more question, I don't know if I can answer real quickly. Yes. So you, when you say okay, I mean, I'm not the officer, I'm not the guy who's gonna stop you. So I'm not gonna, you know, I can only save by the bell. It's a really good question. So officer, you know what, I think Patrick should answer that question, but I'm not gonna go there, but I think I know what he's gonna say. So everybody in the car is intoxicated or drinking, except for the designated driver who's underage. But she, all right, now here's my attorney hat. Officer, she did the right thing. She was morally responsible. She was ethically responsible. She was mature. She's bright. She's got a wonderful future ahead of her. She took the responsibility of taking the, you know, sword and falling on the sword and driving all these people who were drunk home, and she saved their lives. What do you do with her? She's underage driving. Yeah, everybody's underage. You know what? Let me just tell you, that's a seasoned officer. So that's someone who's been around and seen a lot of things. They know the big, they want you alive. They're thankful you did the right thing. They're gonna do the right thing for you.
Folks, we're running out of time. Once again, thank you very much, Judge Martin. Officer Hogan, thank you. folks, you're all very fortunate. You live in a community and attend a school where the adults care very much about you, and part of this program is to help you make the right choice. So thank you very much, and then enjoy the rest of the day.